Center, and he is the master of bioinformatics. So he's going to teach, he's a physicist actually, but he knows a lot about bioinformatics. And so he's going to teach us a little bit about applications in biotechnology and the transformation of biomass into valuable chemicals using enzymes from microorganisms. And thank you, Marcel, for
okay. Thank you, Munir, for the introduction. As Munir said, today I will talk about bioinformatics application in biotechnology, especially in using the construction biomass to produce biochemicals using microorganism fermentation, using a biological pathway, different biological pathways. Bioinformatics is a mix between computer systems and biological systems. The NIH defines bioinformatics as a research, development, or application of computation tools and approaches for expanding the use of biological, medical, or health science, or health data. Bioinformatics is an interdisciplinary area that you must to discuss results and think about new experimentations with many different expertise areas, computer, mathematics, physics, medicine, biology, and chemistry. For this my talk today, it means in the focus in the biotechnology, I think that the computer, physics, chemistry, and biology are the main important technology fields. You must converse with chemicals, chemistries, biologists, and use a lot of physics and computer technologies. Also, the bioinformatician work with many omics experimental approaches. There are a lot of omics approaches available to be explored, to be used for different situations. In this seminar, I will talk about genomics, transcriptomics, and proteomics. Genomics is a science that studies the DNA using DNA sequences methodologies. The main objective of genomics is to identify the sequences of DNA, and to study these six in order to find the genes and also to infer function of these genes. In the transcriptomic area, sorry, I forgot to see here. In the transcriptomic area, we are interested in to study how the concentration of messenger RNA from different genes are changing in function of different times, different conditions, or different tissues. And also in the proteomics, we are interested in the study of how the concentration of proteins is changing in function of several different conditions, time, course, experimentation, or different tissues, and a lot of other ones, things. This omics is best interpreted when you put in the context of central dogma of molecular biology. This dogma says that the DNA inside of the cell has all information that the cell needs to work properly. This information is stored in small pieces of the DNA that you call genes. The information is transcribed from the genes to messenger RNA. This is exactly a copy of the gene regions in the DNA. The messenger RNA is transported from nucleus to cytoplasm and is translated to a protein. The proteins, in the final, the protein is the essential molecule that really does some action in the cell. So if the information are stored in DNA, is passed through the protein, and the protein really does some action in the cell. You can look at this as a different steps from the big reaction. So the omics, the different omics, just are exploring, studying these different steps, in the experimental approach to explore these different steps. So they must, it's more interesting to study the omics not in the dependent way, but in the integrated form. That is called omics integration, and also is called the systems biology. So which omics produce a lot of data that can be interpreted alone, but the more interesting if you can connect the different results, because you are looking just for the different steps of the same large reactions. Yes. So in my talk today, I will talk about bioinformatics application in biotechnology, especially in green chemistry. As you can see in this panel, you can produce a lot of bioproducts using biomass feedstocks, different biomass, and using different routes here. There are several combinations of industrial methodologies to come from biomass to bioproducts. In my specific case, I am studying biochemical pathways using microorganism fermentation to go from biomass to bioproducts. There are several examples in the literature using wild type or genetically modified organisms that you can produce a lot of molecules using this methodology in different conditions, anaerobic conditions, aerobic conditions, or microaerobic conditions. In Brazil, you have a big example of this. We are one of the major player, one of the major player in the world to producing ethanol, for ethanol producing, that we use yeast fermentation to produce the ethanol using sugarcane juice. Why biomass is so important to produce biochemical from microorganisms? Because biomass is a source of soluble sugars. I mean, when I look for this table, I see here a lot of sugars, a big amount of sugars that can be used for microorganisms. So you can see in this slide that you take a little part of this plant, a piece of leaf. If you give a zoom in this part, you see the plant cell. If you give another zoom in this part of cell, the plant cell wall, that it is the border of the cell, you see this kind of structure, these large structures, that is constituted by cellulose, hemicellulose, and lignin. The cellulose is a polymer of glucose, it means that you break the cellulose in small pieces, you find a lot of glucose. The microorganism loves glucose, is more or less like us, in the chocolate, for example. The hemicellulose is a more complicated polymer, is constituted by different sugars, but the major sugars in the hemicellulose is glucose again, and these very important sugars is xylose. This is the pipeline to go from biomass to microorganism fermentation. There are several interesting research areas in which steps of this pipeline you can develop a lot of new scientific studies. In the biomass, for example, you must develop new biomass source that has high biomass productivity, fast growth, large scale production using marginal lands, it is to avoid food competition. In the pretreatment, there are already available several industrial processes or new ones being developed, using chemical pretreatments or physical pretreatments. The biomass must to be submitted for this pretreatment because this is a very hard material. The fibers are very close between them. And so you must open this. Use chemical or physical pretreatment to open the fiber in order to allow that the enzymes can go inside to be some action. Okay? In the enzymatic hydrolysis field, you must develop new enzymatic cocktails. especially if you can develop cocktails that fit for the specific biomass, there is no magic cocktails that can degrade all kind of biomass. It's more interesting if you produce cocktails specific for a specific biomass. And in the field of microorganism fermentation, also development of genetically modified organisms to produce bioethanol using yeast, biobutanol using bacteria, enzymes using fungi, and a lot of examples. I highlight some topics in red because this will be the results that I show in my seminar. This is my main research line. I am developing several researches in several parts of these steps, in different parts of these steps. This is a concept of biorefinery that you would like to change from oil to biomass. It means that you would like to everything that can be produced by oil in the future we would like to produce this using biomass. So now I change my introduction to the results part, the genomic and transcriptomic analysis of energy cane. It is a new biomass source to produce biochemicals. This figure represents what means energy cane. It is a poor soil. It means without fertilization and in the region that you almost never rain. And you can see it is both plants were planted in the same times, of course. And you can see that sugarcane is really suffering, is almost crying, dying in this situation. And while the energy cane is very green, is green, and you can see the high density of biomass that can be produced using this plant. Also, it can be shown in this graphics. Sorry, this is Portuguese, but it means tons of biomass per hectare. We compare sugarcane with energy cane. You can see that sugarcane produces around 92 tons per hectare. And the energy cane, this number was the last year, is around 108 tons per hectare. And using traditional breeding, the provisional to this is in 2020 produce around 250 tons per hectare. If you do an economic analysis of this material, it means if you think it's possible to substitute oil to energy cane to produce everything, if you do this kind of economic analysis, you identify that the tons per hectare in order to be viable to produce this, they must to target of 500 tons per hectare. So it is much more than this, but so it is far to substitute everything from biomass. It cannot be done using traditional breeding. So you must to use a genetic engineering approach to produce genetic modified energy cane in order to obtain this value. So one part of my work is generate the genomic and transcriptomic analysis of energy cane in order to construct a gene catalog, because it is a start point to generate transgenic plants. If you want to generate a transgenic plant, you must have a lot of information about your DNA. So it is the methodology to obtain this information. We call this an instruction manual of the organism. You can use this information, you can learn how the organism works, and of course, in which gene I must change in order to increase your phenotype. In our case, the phenotype is how to increase the biomass per hectare, production per hectare. The energy cane is a large and complex genome. It's a plant from, we call Saccharum complex. The plants in this kind of plant is very complicated genome, the three or four times bigger than human genome. the algorithms, the computational softwares to assemble genomes cannot work in this kind of situation. So we developed a pipeline to perform this analysis. I don't want to go into details of this. If you want to, would like, if you, somebody wants to understand this better, ask me after that. But the most important here, at the final of our pipeline, we identified our gene catalogs. To understand if our gene catalogs is good or not, we compare our results with gene catalogs from MAISE. MAISE is a very, there is a genome, very well studied genome. A lot of people study this genome for many years. So when you do this comparison, the green is always is best, is bigger than red. It means that our genes is good, is best than the actual states of standard states of MAISE genome. So our pipelines worked. Also, I don't want to explain a lot of details about this, just to show that the next step is to use comparative genome analysis, using our catalog genes and the comparison with other genomes, plant closely, phylogenetically close with our genomes. To understand, using this kind of comparison, we can understand what the energy chain has that the other plants doesn't have. And using this information, can again understand how the organism works and where you can interfere in order to increase the phenotype. Okay.
Marcel, the sugar cane is a transgenic plant?
There's already some, there's some plants.
But there's some.
The standard?
No. But you actually, you engineered energy cane or it's some variant of, I don't know, something?
We're working in the direction to generate information to be enough to allow this engineering energy cane. You must just to start.
But the energy cane that we have today, or you
start. It's possible.
The ones that you already have, the ones that you have a plantation of energy cane.
Yeah, no, it's natural.
It's natural.
It's natural.
Oh, it's natural.
It's natural.
It's
wide.
It's
a kind of cane.
It's a kind of cane. But it doesn't have much juice.
No, just a little bit. Just a little bit. But the 250 tons, but this is just wide energy cane produced by traditional breeding methodology. Also, we identify tissue-specific promoters. These are very important regions into the genome. It is necessary to produce genetically modified organisms. So because this is a patent application, because there is some direct application of the sequence in order to produce genetically modify organism. So now I change my talk to enzymatic cocktails. Oi, okay. Quer perguntar outra coisa?
Yeah. The patent is it's a protocol to edit the sugarcane genes. Is that? It's a tool to. So that you can make alterations in the genome of the sugarcane.
Yeah.
It's a pattern that's specific for that because it's a multiple.
Yes. Yes. Large genomes, multiploid, polyploids, and the high heterozygosity. It means which copies with chromosome. There is a lot of difference between them. A lot of SNPs, it is the correct name of this.
SNPs.
SNPs.
Do you guys are trying CRISPR techniques?
Do you guys what?
CRISPR.
Yes, this is a very important.
Yes.
But in order to use it, CRISPR is the most important genetic tools in order to perform, produce genetically modified organisms. But you must, in order to use CRISPR, you must the sequence. You must identify the promoters, you must to find the target genes, and you must understand how the organism works. When we are in this stage now, going to the next one. So now, if you looking, remember the, my pipeline the, from to go from biomass to microorganism, there is one part that work with must to identify novel fungal and bacterial glycosidrolases. In the, my case, we use the termite as a source of information. Termite are considered the most efficient decomposer on the earth. These insects can degrade biomass in the which 90% of cellulose can be degraded by these organisms. 65% of hemicellulose can be degraded also, and this insect can also perform lignin modifications. So the biomass degradation inside of this the insect, the termite, is performed by endogenous enzyme. It means enzyme that is produced in the termite genome, and also by enzyme that is produced from symbiont genomes. There are other organisms that live inside of the termite and then contribute for this process of biomass degradation. This figure is a schematic representation of a termite. You see here amendable. This is the first step of biomass degradation, do a mechanical fragmentation, producing small pieces and 20 micrometers. Then in the foregut and the midgut, there are actions of there are secretion of endogenous enzymes. Different enzymes. In the final part of the midgut, start to secretion of bacterial enzymes. And finally, in the hindgut, there is a secretion of protist enzymes. So, we'd like to understand how the organism works in order to use your enzymes to produce our cocktails. Because in the nature already is done this for us. Né?
You see, protist enzymes.
Protozoários.
So there's protozoa inside the...
Yeah, there. Yes. They are very important for the termite. Yeah. So when you perform transcriptome or proteomics in the mixings of organisms, you are doing meta-transcriptome and meta-proteomics. We use this approach to study this system. Again, I do not work in many details about the pipelines, but we study soldiers, individuals, and worker individuals in this, because they have different feedings. We identify sequences from fungi, bacteria, protists, and insecta. Of course, insecta, because the most of the RNA are expressed by termite the genome. And you also identify a lot of glycosyl hydrolase enzymes, we call GH domains. Several of them. This figure represents the main important result of our work. It's just a high throughput analysis of the system, and you can identify in the endogenous enzymes by transcriptome or proteomics, or only by transcriptome, a lot of combination of these, several glycosyl hydrolases, auxiliary oxidative enzymes. In the protist enzymes, we find also a lot of glycosyl hydrolases, and also bacterial enzymes in different parts of the insect. Now, the final part of my talk, I'd like to talk a little bit about the genetically modified yeast to produce bioethanol from lignocellulose biomass. This is the last part of the pipeline. So, Brazil produces ethanol using sugarcane juice and the industrial yeast fermentation process. One ton of sugarcane can produce around 160 kilo of sucrose that can be converted to 880 liter of ethanol using yeast. It you call first generation ethanol produced. With development of industrial methodology for biomass deconstruction, you can now use bagasse and straw, degrade this material, degrade this construction, this material, in order to free, to generate glucose and xylose. This 60 kilos of glucose can be converted to 30 liters of ethanol, and 30 kilos of xylose can be converted for 70 liters of ethanol. It is called second degeneration ethanol, and there is a possibility to increase the national production by 40%. This is really today in Brazil, there is two industries working in this kind of process, but there is a problem. Yeast loves sucrose, yeast loves glucose, but yeast cannot consume xylose. So it is white yeast, okay? But if you produce genetic engineered yeast, you can allow the yeast to consume xylose. So there are two different routes that you can do, two different genes that you can put in the yeast genome in order to allow that yeast produce xylose, consume xylose and produce ethanol. The first one is a combination of two enzymes from fungi, xylose reductase and xylitol dehydrogenase. If you put these two genes in the yeast genome, the yeast can start to consume xylose. But this pathway is not good because there are unbalance of cofactors here. If you see this enzyme using NADH pH, and this one produces NADH, so it is not good. This combination that makes a unbalance redox in the cell, and this process, because this process cannot work very well. The second possibility is using a xylose isomerase gene from bacteria. Is a very interesting gene because there is no consumption or production of cofactors, and of course doesn't spend ATP. But if you take this gene and put inside of the yeast, you cannot see any xylose consumption. Also, it's already described in literature. Also there's the solution. The solution is using this a very important tool for biotechnology, also the cause evolutionary engineering, that you put this cell with this genetically modified yeast using xylose isomerase inside the genome, and you keep this yeast for several weeks using xylose as a only carbon source. You force that the organism consume xylose, otherwise he will die. So after several weeks or several months, the magic is happened. Suddenly the yeast started to consume xylose. And the question now is, what's changing the DNA during evolution time to allow the xylose consumption? So we have a parental that cannot consume, and we have an evolving strain after several weeks or months that suddenly starts to consume. So in order to answer this question, we sequence the DNA from parental and evolved strains, we assemble these genomes, and you perform comparative genome between them in order to understand what changed in your DNA. There are two different possibilities. One is called copy number variation. That means in this example, the parental genome has just one copy of gene called C, and after the evolution time, the gene C duplicate is one possibility. And there is one other possibility, that the gene C after evolution time just disappeared in the genome, was deleted. Other possibility also, it's very common to find, is the SNPs, when just one base pairs in the genome change, and it can be related with the phenotype. So we're looking for these events and single nucleotide polymorphisms. One base pair of genome change.
It changes in one of the alleles or?
In this case, we are working with haploid cell, so we just one allele. But you can change just in one allele if you have a diploid. This is called heterozygote site. It after some time also can become homozygote.
So it's single nucleotide. The P is what?
Polymorphism. So the comparative analysis identifies several SNPs. We did not find any CNV events, copy number variation events, but several SNPs. But only one SNP was inside of the gene. When the mutation was reproduced in the parental, it means you take the mutated gene from evolved strain and put and substitute this gene in the mutate in the parental strain. You find these results. It is the parental strain without any evolution. It is the evolved strain, the squares, so we start to consume slow. This result is the same result that I showed before. And you take the SNP from evolved strain and put in the parental strain. The magic happens, the yeast start to yeast shilose. Also, it's the publication and the patent application is coming soon. I don't want to talk a little more about this because this is what I'd like to show. Okay.
Before we thank you first. I want to ask a question
okay.
before I open the floor to questions. Since you are convinced.